Excellent. So, as per the original starting slide, this is for one night only. This is a and this is I'm also thinking of the recording. This is a unique run through of this presentation, partly because I've added to it recently, partly because of the way it's built. Also, thank you very much for the title, Elise, for Don't Be Afraid to Play Games at Work, which, being so near Halloween for the United States, I mean, essentially I think Halloween's kind of a religious holiday, but I couldn't really fit that theme in. So there is an occasional pumpkin when I've, which is kind of to remind me of the emphasis on how some of this might be scary to some people in the audience who haven't run games at work. But apart from that, trying to think of sort of I don't know, witches and spiders and trick or treat or so on. There's nothing like that tend. This reminds me, I've got my fan on, I can write notes on something. I've got paper. I've managed to make this work on Zoom, which is always good. How's the lighting look? Oh, I'm a bit. It's a bit bright, but that'll be fine. We're not waiting. We're getting into it. This is an experiment. This of a sort. This presentation style is an experiment to see if it will work or fail. So far, for me, it's worked. So if it fails, I think I'm going to blame the audience, especially how many of you that I know. What we'll do, rather than sort of a more traditional presentation where sort of I'm the one in the light and you're the audience, I will be asking for feedback, but only via the chat. That way, the text chat, which you should be able to get to and you should have open. That reminds me of the controls. It looks something like that, but with a different title. Just your answers to questions or any incidental questions you have. Actually, do put in there and I'll answer them as and when I can. So, this is a presentation about playing games at work, but only up to a point. I'm the one who will be saying things. You're the ones who decide what I say. So, out of those three choices, what would you like me to cover next? Please, can you put one, two, or three into the chat box and I'm going to ask Elise to, oh man, tell that audience. Okay, so no one's interested in me. Everyone's interested in game. Oh, that is not the slide I expected, but I'll go with it. No, that is not the slide I expected. Oh no, those slides messed up horribly. I'll explain them. Basically, the kind of game I've got in mind is what in military wargaming terms is called a rehearsal of concept game. In emergency response is called a crisis management game. Is the kind of game where you play through a situation and see how that situation would turn out. So rather than the traditional board games that some of you might be more used to, or maybe sort of a really simple icebreaker game, some of those of you with coming from a facilitation background might be used to, something more exploratory and analytical. And like the slide I've showed there, something more team analysis focused than team building. I mean, a lot of games that traditional workplaces play are just getting people to talk to each other about something different and getting them all in the same room doing something. The game I've shown there, which is a game called Evive by a mainly Indian company called Gamitar, is a game that gets you to potentially work together as a group to mine resources towards an aim, which is explained at the start of the game. But it's a really what I'd call a professional game for focusing on world build, focusing on team analysis. Who does what? How do people divide up tasks? That kind of thing. So what I'm thinking of is games that are like tabletop role-playing games, which are is a particularly well, if you're not familiar with it, it's a difficult concept to explain, kind of. It's basically amateur dramatics around a board run by a single games master or dungeon master. But the thing with role-playing games, Dungeons and Dragons being the most famous one, is that it's kind of based on resource management when you think about it. If you're an adventuring party in a fantasy situation, you've got a set of different roles, the mage, the cleric, the barbarian, the fighter, and so on. And you've got a bunch of resources you have, which might be arrows or food or spells to achieve a particular task. It's, don't say this to the, if you're a role player, don't take offense. If you're not, don't say this to the role players, but it's basically resource management for fun. It's a very decision focused game. So more than the example I like to use is Monopoly. More than Monopoly, which is very individual, tabletop role playing games are very decision focused and very much about working together and everybody's individual aims as well. That kind of game, I think, has a place in the workplace. Especially, it's unusual compared to the games that most people play in that it's facilitated. So you have a DM, a dungeon master, or a GM, a games master, managing essentially everything in the imagined world that isn't the players and making decisions about what happens. For a business context, this kind of game is really useful if you play either yourself in your role or play other, it can be other people in your company and you just get to learn what their role is. Or you just play in an imaginary situation, but you're actually in that situation, you make decisions in that situation, and then the facilitator describes what happens, and then you move on from that position. The thing I particularly like about role-playing games, and I think needs to be brought in a lot more into professional games, is hidden information. Is so much of our business decision, sorry, so many of our business decisions are made without full knowledge. And I think innately, humans just hate that. Humans don't like making decisions, not knowing things, and just want more and more information, more and more data before they'll finally make a choice. Learning to make decisions with limited information is part of the reason the military, for example, play war games. And I think also that's something to get business people to focus on more. This is, as the pumpkin reminds me, this is sort of war, military war game-ish. The thing with military war games is they usually involve multiple parties. A lot of what the military do involves adversaries and allies and other different parties involved in what the situation is. And so where there are sources of potential conflict. To me, for business war games, it's any kind of conflict. It can be a rival companies trying to take over the same market, rather than anything more sort of military terms, kinetic or adversarial than that. But it's still multiple parties with different aims competing over the same resources. And the main thing for me with war games is that it's about decisions and consequences, and this is what separates it from many other games. Is that the players make a decision, the facilitators work out the consequences of that decision, they also work out what the other parties in that situation would do, or the players are playing all the parties involved in the game at once. And then everybody has to make a decision based on the new situation, that new situation being the result of what everybody decided. That kind of evolving iterative situation, getting people to think in those kind of situations, simulating business decisions that people make, I think is really useful and key. And don't a lot of the useful techniques here come from war game, but the pumpkin is to remind me to say, don't be scared of that as a history. And you don't need any of the connotations of war game. You don't even need to use the term. Facilitators in war games tend to be called control with a capital C because they arguably control the game. And again, that's this kind of situation is where you're playing yourself or others. A great way to say understand a business rival is to have a facilitated game where you're playing the rival business. You're given their resources, you're given their rough aims. The facilitator describes that to you. And then they don't say in that situation, what would you do? They say, you are that company. You have these roles in that organization. Here are your names. Here's the description of you in the Washington Post or the New York Times or whatever. make a decision like that person, get into their head and context as much as possible. It helps you understand a lot more what organizations do. The thing I really like, and I'll avoid looking at some of the faces staring back at me, is I'm aiming to take some of the fun out of war games. Hobby war games, recreational war games. A lot of the enjoyment of that is the complete view of being able to see what's going on a battlefield and playing against someone you're looking across. I mean, the same as a game of chess is seeing either how you've turned the tide of a game and you can see the reaction in the body language of your opponent, or you're just talking to each other as you play. It's a social occasion. If you're modeling business processes and business conflicts, that's not what happens. So I think having you separate from everybody else playing that game, having you separate from other teams and other players playing that game, where the only thing you've got is your own information, is a really useful reflection of business context. It's much less fun. And as I say, humans don't like not knowing things, and forcing people to make decisions in that situation is uncomfortable, but you acclimatize them to that through that kind of game. To give you an example, I notice here, I helped design for Stone Paper Scissors, a game called The Business, which is basically about running a business. As you can see here, people sat around a central table which has tracks showing how well or how badly the business has done. And people at the other tables representing different parts of the company. So, co-designed with Stone Paper Scissors, which Jim Wallman in the audience is the head of. Each player is a department. Each department has a staff and budget. So, people are controlling their own aims and want their department to do well, but also want the company to do well. And of course, if the company doesn't survive, then it doesn't matter how well their department has done, the company is done. So balancing those individual aims is really useful for people to see in a game. And this is sort of an invented and very abstract company, but it just helps people think that through. And you respond to crises and opportunities in the company turn by turn. It's not that realistic in that an awful lot happens very quickly. Turns don't have a simulated length of time. It's just when a turn is done, you move on to the next set of events rather than they represent a week or a month or a year, something like that. But it helps people see progression, helps people see building business relationships, and helps people see about sort of using resources where you can, helping out other departments. Now, the problem with this is, again, looking at many of the game design in the audience will realize, is what customers want is what you see on the left, which is a nice menu of options. This is how much you pay, this is how much you get. With games, I see them very much as a toolbox, which is, and in this sort of slightly tortured metaphor, it's a buffet. It's here's a whole set of stuff. Build what you want yourself, which is part of the conversation you have with a customer. If you want to run games in your organization, it's part of the conversation you have with your whoever's sponsoring the game, whoever is wants you to run the event. Is part of that conversation is what do you want to get out of this? Here's the variety of tools I have. You know, in this metaphor, here's the variety of food. What do you want on your plate? Because there's so many different methods available. So that's a very vague description of just how I see games in a business context, sort of role play game based. So looking at these three options, what would you like to know next? If you just type the number into the chat, and I'll take a quick oh yeah, I'd spot the gaming people there. Okay, where doesn't this apply? Where should you not play games? Looks like the most popular one. No, my presentation has interestingly gone horribly wrong on Google. So Google Slides might determine what we discuss next. Let me see how this goes.
It
An
looks like you've
argument.
got some twos and ones in there, so you know.
Okay, let's see. Oh no, this has gone horribly wrong. This is, yeah, I mean, this is all the latest version. I assume the sharing has stopped.
Absolutely not.
Oh, so you get to see the magic behind this. Where were you? We
Yeah,
were like,
all your
where do they?
DM secrets are right out there.
What we were, this was, oh yeah, that is so it was where do games not apply? Let me give you actually what you asked for, even if that involves scrolling through all of this. There we go. Let's
Sweet.
there we go. That might happen quite a lot. Well, let's see how we get on. Where they don't apply is where there's a simpler and quicker process. This is taken from the MOD Wargaming Handbook, which is basically if you want a, if you've got a high complexity problem and there's low immersion, kind of what people do doesn't matter that much, as a very simple way of putting that. If you want to model the game, something like a computer model, in the same way the other way around, a synthetic environment is where you want people to be really involved if in training, but it's a relatively low complexity environment. For example, relatively low complexity, you're driving a tank. You can't learn how to actually drive a tank or say pilot an aircraft through a game. You want to actually be in a ideally a computer simulation, something that simulates the controls in front of you. But when you've got a combination of those, for example, in a military situation, you're making decisions about where the tanks are being sent to and why. In a business situation, rather than something really hands-on, as you know, for example, operating machinery, you want a synthetic environment, or you actually want on-the-job training. If you want more judgment about making calls about which of your staff are operating what machines that day to produce what, depending on what orders you're either you've had in or you're expecting to get in, that kind of decision-making environment where it's can be relatively abstract, can be simulated, then you want something like what I would call a war game. Until the customer says they want a different term, but it's that kind of decisions and consequences. It's that there's no specified way for this to go until people make decisions, and then through the game, however it's set up, however it's constructed, you get them to explore the decisions in the same way as you saw with the business. People sat around a set of tables, moving blocks around, negotiating with their colleagues about which resources they should put where. Get people to play through that and learn what happens rather than get them to do that with an actual sort of live factory, live warehouse full of people. There are other arguments against games, especially, and again, resisting the urge at looking at people's faces, they're more draining than other facilitation experiences or events, I would argue. Because if they're done well, they're dynamic, which means you don't know what's going to happen, which means that you've got to be sort of full on all the time to manage what might happen. So it can't, I mean, I've done some facilitation where I'm given the same training course, for example, and by the fifth day of doing that for a week, I was hitting sort of the right word at the right point in the training video. Absolutely spot on to the millisecond. And also I was only half there until we got to questions and answers because I'd done it like 10 times that week in a game. As with sort of what people complain about with, well, not complain, what people say about recreational tabletop role-playing games is players will make a decision and it messes up your entire scenario, your entire plan. For it in the same way with a business game that's based on this war game like methodology, you might have to think, you have to think on the fly literally all the time. You will tend to need more facilitators because you've got to have more interaction with the players than, again, if I would argue a standard facilitation exercise where everybody's probably doing the same thing. Everybody's working together in the same way. Everybody's generating the same results. And also, I mean, the main reason to be sort of be worried about this, but it's not a reason not to do it, is that games are more unpredictable in that, like I say, play, because so much, if you run them well, so much is based on players' decisions. Therefore, you don't know which way it's going to go. You can guide them and you can warn them, but still, it's just a case of being ready for a lot more consequences than you might have expected. Right. Where to next? Maybe depending on what my presentation software does. So if you can type a number in here, and then we'll see what happens. And I, looking at the great conversation happening, I hope we're going to save the chat after this. Right, if it's going to be a bit fastest fingers wins. Oh, so that looks like a one. Let's see. Yeah, let's. How do I start? Let's brace myself. Oh, excellent. Thank you, Google. Typical consultant answer, which I've been previous in a previous life. It depends for games. How do you start? The British Military Defence MOD term is what's the master question, which is I think is a good focus for if you're getting into a game. It's basically what you want to answer with the game. Of course, in the MOD, that can be quite focused. In military situations, it's quite focused of. Will we have enough resources to achieve this aim? Will we be able to get supply somewhere? Will we be able to defend a particular area? That kind of thing. In business, it can be more general, but have something in mind. What is the point of this game? That, I mean, the point might be, can we get all these different teams to talk to each other about something that's not sort of a weekly argument in a meeting about allocation of resources or something? Factors that affect this include budget. Include the existing psychological safety of your organization in that you don't want to build a game that gives teams who don't get on anyway another reason to argue with each other. So that's something that a game designer will build in. It's a case of how many players you want. It's kind of which location or locations they're in, which locations you want them to be in. For example, this kind of game's really good for those increasingly rare off-site meetings where you're getting everybody together. If you want to give people a reason to talk to each other rather than the CEO is going to give a presentation, we're going to go over the latest corporate strategy, so on and so forth, is get them playing a game with each other or a set of games with each other. People get to make new connections there, which will last for the rest of their time with your organization. As I say, it's online or offline. A factor to take in mind, to keep in mind, is whether your staff generally are gamers and game literate or not, which can work both ways. If they really understand games, then you can be quite advanced in the mechanics and the methodologies you use. If they're not, if they're the sort of a typical employee whose most complex game they've played is potentially Monopoly, you don't want to throw them in the sort of in the deep end with deep mechanics and have them just feel lost. You want people to be maybe frustrated in the game, but you don't want them to be frustrated by the game. So that's another thing to keep in mind. The key is how much time you've got to play the game, what deadline there is, how much time you have to prepare it. Is it a case of, like I was reading in a game design group, someone I know has been given, I think, a couple of weeks to come up with a 45-minute game. Not very long. You don't have time to be that complex just in your design. Also, synchronous or asynchronous. So synchronous play means it's much more direct. Everybody's playing the game together. Asynchronous means that people m submit moves at different times. I haven't heard about this happening very often. I personally think it's a great idea and someone should pay me to implement it. Is people taking on a role within the game and then through something like email, they submit moves at different times. In the way that the people have been playing games by post for, oh, at least 50, 60 years and play games by email, you can do something like that where it's a game kind of going on in the background, gets people thinking about a business situation. Something like that might be possible and might suit your organization where you're not getting everybody together at the same time. Maybe people don't even work in the same time zone, but you want them to think on something. You want them to do something interesting. And maybe you want to see about new ideas in a situation. So get them to play an online game or a game by email where they submit their moves, submit their orders at different times. Also, with this, try running tiny experiments in your organization. something I need to get into, thanks to some recent work, I can finally buy a new printer which will work, is getting to the idea of solo games, games people play on their own. But it's a much more interactive learning experience about a situation and being able to replay the situation that the game describes over and over again, print and play. And or you can do this facilitated if you want. I've heard a lot about the competitiveness in the C-suite. Let's put it that way. So getting the C-suite, for example, to play a business game is getting a set of people who can have antagonistic relationships with low psychological safety, to make decisions in a sort of fictitious high-speed environment can cause all sorts of problems, which then means that those people don't get to play with different business decisions, which then impairs the business. So what you can do is essentially do that kind of tabletop role-playing game idea, but you just have one player, which is, say, the CTO. They're thinking about making a new investment. You get them to describe it as the sort of business DM. You tell them roughly what the response to that is. Use some dice to bring in some unknown factors, so to keep it engaging and stop it just being a decision that you make. And then ask them what they do in response to the consequences of their decisions. That way, they get to explore situations that the company hasn't been through yet, but they're not doing it around their colleagues who, as I say, there's it really depends on the company, but there might be all sorts of issues there. Something I did with NATO was not quite a game, but was like an incremental survey. They would give you a situation and then ask you what you would do in that situation with this technology against this threat. You fill in a kind of survey. They then give you a situation which moves beyond that, but not related to the answers you gave, just kind of in general, and then ask you for another survey. So it was engaging enough that your opinion mattered and they were clearly listening to responses. But it wasn't a full war game or role-playing game whereby your decisions directly affected what happened next. But it was definitely a game with a process, with progression and with you as a player making decisions. And they said that format, they get a lot better information out of that rather than just like a general meeting or a discussion. An idea I really like is tactical decision games. Again, something I've not had a chance to implement a lot and discuss with other people is a US Marine Corps concept whereby you're in the US Marine Corps, you're given a map and a set of a description of what unit you're in control of and an objective, and you're given 15 minutes to come up with a plan. In the group of Marines in the training session, you will then present that plan to everyone. They will then critique it. But in this case, sort of you come up with something on the fly, which is the kind of thing you have to do in real life, and then people explain maybe what errors you've made or how it could be improved, or congratulate you on the decisions you've made. In the same way, doing that in business can help people get used to making quick decisions and exploring different options and being experimental and seeing what consequences they get from that rather than just standard meetings, standard kind of decisions whereby the sort of fastest and or loudest and or most senior person in the room makes a decision, everybody else nods, and that's what the company does. A experienced facilitator I haven't seen in a few years, but saw I read this recently on LinkedIn called Alison Coward, who thinks about this. An article she wrote recently called "Team Time Together: Designing Impactful Offsites for a New Era of Work." The way we work together has changed. So when you do get people together for something offsite or something that's work but away from your usual work environment, even if you're all in the same office, but no one's checking their email for a day. What do you do with that? And what she did, a really almost offensively simplistic summary of her article and thinking. I'll make sure that's shared on the forum. It's just if this is what you want as your primary goal, if this is what you want, this is your primary goal, so this is what you do. And just making it clear to think about why you're actually doing this rather than, well, we have an offsite because we should and I have an offsite and get people together. Is more, what is the purpose of this offsite? How long do we want an impact from this? And also, which can involve Who do I need to prove the value of this to? And this kind of table helps you think around what to actually run. In the same way, saying this in front of the people who are watching me on a recorded medium, I ought to put something together for this for game-based methods. For and also thinking of someone who's going to, I know, is going to be watching the recording. They've already done this, in that the different kinds of game you want satisfy different aims. And really thinking about that means you get much better value than gamification is a kind of hot word right now. Someone who knows about games gamifies something. Everybody kind of wonders what the point was. If you're more thoughtful about the kind of game you run, you can get really good results out of it, and much better than a standard meeting. But it requires this kind of thinking to about what you want to run. So we're doing all right for time. So I don't think I need to finish the presentation yet, but that's up to you. We might have answered three already. Oh, and two. So let me see. Pick your numbers. I might have to use an Americanism. I might have to call an audible and just pick a different one. So everybody says two. If that takes us to the section I've just described, then I will spin that into showing you a problem with this kind of format. Oh, all right. Well, I'm gonna go with this one though. I'm not sure I've answered the question I asked you to all to ask. What the games cost is also, it depends. And this is the, of course, cost if you're doing this in a corporate environment is a huge factor. Again, is it in person, online, or hybrid? And it's either does the format of where everybody's meeting decide the cost, or does the cost decide where everybody meets for this? The number of participants, and therefore the number of what in war game terms is control, the number of facilitators you need is another factor. Also, the number of teams, especially as I've explained sort of generally so far. Is that these kind of games are not everybody sat around the same board. As you saw with the business, the fact that different players were sat on their own table in charge of their own department. If you spread that out wider to a larger game, you really need one member of the control. You really need one facilitator for each team. Depending how many decisions the players will need to make, and how many questions they might have. Something I like to think I've learned, arguably the hard way, is as soon as players have a question in an environment like this, you need to answer them as soon as possible. If any of you are experienced with role-playing games, you know that the you know players, the way that the reason part of the reason that format works so well is that there's say at most six players. And they can get quick answers out of the games master, the dungeon master, on what can I do? What are my options? What does, say, if it's a simple combat, what does the monster look like? Or something more complex, you know, like tell me more about the world we're in. And everybody gets that answer immediately. If you're simulating a business situation, I think you want teams more separate because, you know, usually your entire company isn't all in the same location at once, all having the same location. Also, all having the same conversation, all looking at the same dashboard, the same portrayal of resources. They're all in different places with different aims, with their own sets of resources, making different decisions. You want to simulate that in a game, but to do so, you need many more facilitators than just the one. Also, yeah, I mean, this is always a talk in itself, is if you're running a business game, do you want to fully simulate a company, which you could do as like a digital twin, a properly analyzed simulation of an organization, even copies, especially with cloud technology, even copies of certain resources that people can use, but massively expensive to sort out. Or you can have something imagined. You can essentially invent a company or a situation and get people to just play through it. That's what I do sometimes in cybersecurity incident response is just to teach people the value of it in general and the value of the things you don't expect, things like clear communication rather than technical knowledge. Is you can do that with any imagined cybersecurity situation. You don't need to base it on the company. So for that, that's, and of course, that's a lot cheaper because we as game designers can build a fictitious company for you. Or you can do it as an approximation of a company. You can learn just enough about them to have a rough idea of sort of who they are and what they do. But rather than allocating specific resources in turns within the game, it's much more approximate. You would give them, for example, a certain number of resource points as a generic designation, de sorry, generic designation of all their resources, and they can then get them to allocate that appropriately. Things you can do, also, I mean, cost depends so much on this. I mean, that buffet I hinted at is so wide. As I say, you can run, say, a solo game with a single member of the C-suite, get them to talk through a decision, invent as the facilitator, you invent some consequences, get them to talk through their subsequent decision. They get to explore a situation in complete privacy. The only person they're talking to is you. There's no psychological risk from them. They can be as experimental or as ridiculous or as confused as they like. It's completely safe. Another game format I really like, and I'm gonna call him out, even though he won't like it. Jim Wallman is a member of the audience. Jim Wallman, I don't think it's grandfather. I think it's the father of Mega Games, basically. He's not even looking at the camera. He's so British, but it's like, to be blunt, as with others as well, Jim Wallman is a big bloody deal because Mega Games are amazing. A mega game is anything between 50 and 300 players all playing the same game, and also parts of that game together, originally based on to maul the history of the format horribly, based on military decision making roughly. Then expanded further than that. Recently, like within the last 10 years, a lot of different scenarios, a lot of genres, say fantasy and science fiction type scenarios, and getting people together just to play what can kind of be a huge board game is kind of a huge live role playing event. Absolutely fascinating. Something I played in, which Jim ran, was a replay of one of the first mega games called Memphis Mangler 4. It was based on a scenario in the Vietnam War, and just the illustration of confusion and chaos when you're involved in that kind of situation between different parties who can't communicate effectively with each other, just through a few screens in a large room, couldn't see each other. You could hear things were happening, but you didn't know what. Was at a very abstract level, and of course, nothing like being involved in the real thing, but just showed how confusing those situations can be. Whereas if you play a simulation of war on a board, you've just got a big green rectangle in front of you, and you can see everything, and you can clearly talk to everybody, and you can see all the dice rolls, and it all seems really well constructed and formulated. Whereas it's just, I mean, as with Mega Games, especially, even if you're the facilitators, there are entire threads of that game you didn't see. You don't know what happened. It's a really collaborative, improvisational experience, which is a lot like modern business decisions. So much going on. You've got eyes on just some of it. Oh yes, Dr. Scott as well. Yes, 990. I was thinking, I'm overdue a conversation with you about, I think what you've run is what I would call a mega game, but isn't. But I mean, Mega game people are a bit tired of trying to define it. They just like doing it. First steps to doing a game is, to be honest, ask me. Happy to help, and either for money or just out of interest, to be quite clear. It's if you're interested in what I'm saying and you want to pay me, then you get to tell me when you want an answer by. If not, you go into my inbox and I'll answer as soon as I can. Or ask in public. Ask on the MIC forum. Is and also, ask. other people to for recommendations of who they've used, what works in their particular business, what works in their context. As I say, do hire me for money or others. And the game community in general, as shown by the faces I recognize here today, is really relatively small, really friendly, really cooperative, because I think we all can see just how big this could be and how beneficial it could be to organizations. So we'll happily pass on work to other people or work together, work with or for each other. Or just experiment. Try something relatively simple. Try an off-the-shelf business game, or maybe even like a business-themed board game with staff. See if people get excited. See if people get interested. A term used in a different context I like for this is find the believers. With a lot of cybersecurity initiatives I've been involved in, the thing is to find the local champions. I think they tend to be called, and you hear this in general IT as well, is find the people who see why you're doing what you're doing and will support you anyway. And get them convinced. And then they know the people local to them, the people in their silo, the people in their office, the people in their team. And they can explain the benefits to them rather than you trying to contact everybody in your organization. So that's the first step to doing this kind of thing. Meta lessons. I think this has ended the presentation for me. So if it has, we'll stop. I've seen loads of questions go past. We can answer those. Yes, this is. I did test this presentation. Excuse me, pointing up my screen. I did test this presentation like 2 hours ago. But this is the problem with this kind of format. So the meta lessons I have shown you through this presentation are, you can see I could fit the content to the time, except Google has decided this is when I stop. It gives you an opportunity to engage, interact. Sort of at worst, you've put in numbers, but you and Google have decided where this presentation goes. More so than if I was just like going through the slides, I've rehearsed a lot more, and they're all in one order, which means they would appear as I expected them to. But it's something I've said before. It might be something you've heard before. It's a less effective way to use this format than something more interactive like this. The subject's covered a kind of organic. It's been interesting to see, for example, I mean, I'll take it as because so many of you know me. It's nobody asked, nobody wanted the introduction, which is also the worst, the personal introduction, which is also the worst way to start any presentation is, you're not here to learn about me, you're here to learn about the subject. So as I say, the value is in the interaction. So which is the same as with a game, is a game is just a game. Like a game doesn't do anything. For example, you could ask me for the slides for this and excuse me, see what order they should have been in. Although they're in, as you can see, the order goes backwards and forwards. But it's just a set of words and bullet points. The value is in the questions I've raised. I should try and go through some of them, and the me seeing what you were interested in and seeing what numbers came up. In the same way, when you the value of a game is in getting staff to play a game and interact with each other and interact with the subject of the game. And yes, they are very simple, so not simple enough. Well, demonstrated the limitations of CYA, choose your own adventure, which is aggressively trademarked. So be careful if you know that term, but especially if you're American. But that kind of choice of which of these three options do you want, pick one. You could see there Google, with the mess these slides are, saved me, that you can go around in loops. And that kind of training is more interactive than just a slide deck, just a presentation. But it's less interactive than a full game where you have to think off the top of your head, think on the fly. So what next? Maybe run a game here, though I'll fight Google Slides first. The main thing for this, those of you who aren't familiar with playing games at work and are interested in the area, is as per the pumpkin, don't be afraid. Do something. Just Start something minor, even like just raise the subject in conversation at work and see what people say. Either, and then you know the context you're operating in. Are people dismissive? Do people think it's, well, you know, game, we're going to play a game at work. It's something kids do. You don't, we're serious business professionals, we're adults. We don't need to do that. So you know how you're going to need to reframe it. Alternatively, if they say, well, we don't have time, you know, oh, I've read about business games. They're really expensive and they take a week and people do these big complex simulations. Then you know that you're going to have to explain how they can be done really simply, like a really informal role-playing session in a meeting room for a couple of hours. It doesn't need to be massive expense involving the whole organization, that kind of thing. That is my email address. That is my LinkedIn URL. But that, thanks mainly to Google, though the timing's not bad, that is the end of the presentation. Do you have, well, I was going to say, do you have any questions? If Elise wants to manage the questions, and I'll scroll all the way up and see if I can pick some out as well.
There's a lot of comments in there.
There
The
is.
root of the question that I see, and maybe this is me being selfish because it's certainly mine. It occurs to me that we need some sort of like apprenticeship opportunity, or like if people want to become the people who bring this to their clients, how do they know
That's
more than D&D? Well, right. Like when I think about bringing Dungeons and Dragons to my clients, I think there's a good way never to get hired again.
Oh no, oh I excuse
But
me, no, I'm
and
gonna
I know
rudely
that wasn't the only one, but like
no, do
you know
that. That's it. That's it.
how
Stop there. No, absolutely do that. For excuse me being so rude, especially recorded, so people can play it back at me, but no, bring Dungeons and Dragons to your organization. If necessary, don't call it Dungeons and Dragons. Call it something else. There's a whole slide, and I might in a minute sort of show you behind the curtain and find the list. There's a whole set of terms you can use that aren't that. Like immersive exercises is a really good one for using the business terms that get people to pay you training rates from their training budget, and it's just D&D. The main thing about this is D&D is fantastic for teaching people social skills and decision making. Now, and there's all sorts of studies and examples of people using it to everything from treat PTSD to literally just teaching people social skills who struggle with that. Also, that kind of role playing, if you're a business DM, which I have been called and ought to take on and ought to take that on more in some way, is it's just doing what facilitators like yourself do, which is managing a group and saying, but a bit more, I'd argue, not knowing your area of work specifically, I'd argue a bit more focused on this is what the situation is. What decisions do you make? Okay, you've made those decisions. Here are the consequences. Now, what decisions do you make after that? Here is a business situation. For example, human resources, I think, is really good for this. It's a case of here's an employee. Do you hire them or not? Yes or no? Okay, you have, here's what they do. Here's how the team gets better. What are you going to do next as the players in this game? Are you going to spend training on them? Are you going to hire even more? Here's how the market has responded. Oh, okay, now there is a problem with a staff member. How do you deal with it? Are you going to talk to them? Are you just going to fire them? Are you going to reprimand them? Are you going to talk to their colleagues? Right. Okay. So think about that decision. Make that decision. Now let's replay that through. That's business D&D. For and excuse me, so rudely talking over you, but really, if you just call it whatever gets buy-in from your customer. And then just have that conversation with them because right now, business decision making is terrible. I don't think it's speaking out of turn to say that corporate organizations in general are just awful compared to the how smart people are and how much resource they have. So if you can do that to help them make better decisions, I think it's really worth doing.
Thank you. Aaron, did you want to come off mute and ask your question?
Sure. Hi, everybody. Sorry to be off video. And thanks, Nick, for seeing. I was just really curious about whether there's a, maybe it's more of a trickle up than a trickle down effect, a trickle up effect of organizations that adopt gaming. Do leaders start to realize the kinds of the correlation between psychologically safe environments and stronger decisions, better innovation? Dr. Zimmerman is shaking his head no emphatically. I was just curious if anyone on the call has explored that relationship. And
Oh,
my point was, I could imagine a player feeling, much like corporate retreats, a player feeling like it's all well and good when I leave the room, but when I get back, if I make this same kind of decision, you're gonna fire my patootie.
there is, I will rudely say we won't bring them in now, but I hope they contribute to the forum or get comments on there in future. There is decades of experience watching this presentation, which is both intimidating and brilliant. Thank you all for attending. My answer, and you're welcome to continue to watch people's faces and see what they do. My answer is typical consultant answer is it depends. It really depends on the organization, and it's play that situation iteratively. As in, first of all, as I interpreted your question, sort of how do you get games in the first place? And is it either the seniors see the point, get buy-in, and it comes down from someone like a chief learning officer, or people start doing it informally, which reminds me of my previous history, sort of administrating Linux and Unix boxes in organizations, is you almost do it in a guerrilla tactic sort of way at the bottom of the organization, and then everybody suddenly realizes you've stopped using the Windows operating system in a lot of places. That might be the way to do it. It depends on the organization. And also the whole, if I'm experimental in this game and try something that fails, you all say this is only a game and it's fine. But if I was actually to do that in the real world, or just because even if I've done it in a game and entertained the idea, will I get fired? It really, again, I'm being such a consultant. It really depends on the organization. But that is where, as someone bringing in games to an organization, you need to get buy-in from the top. So when the senior stands up at the start and says, this is an experimental, game-based, playful environment, we want you to make mistakes and learn from them here, rather than in the real world with a real business, with a real budget and a real bank accounts. Then I'm endorsing this. I'm the one standing up and saying that you should do this. Also, especially in that case, and sort of looking over to some of the people here, there's a corollary to military environments where then that very senior person just goes away and does something else. So it's like, we're here to, I'm here to endorse what this event is. I'm here for you to experiment, and I'm so trusting in the people running it and in you, my staff. I'm not going to watch this. I'm not going to look over your shoulders. I had that in the last couple of weeks. They're like a couple of people with chief at the start of their title were involved, but many weren't. And it was very much like we trust the people who've paid for and organized this event. We don't need to look over your shoulders and make sure you do anything you shouldn't. If anything, we want you to make those mistakes so you learn in this playful game-based environment. But thank you. That's a great question. And we'll talk more about that another time if you want to. Is there anything else I should answer?
Scott's hand is so up.
Oh, geez. Yeah. Go on, Scott. Hit us with.
I've been playing for 30 years in this exact environment and working with CEOs and all. I think the real key to the big picture is, does the suggested exercise align with the goals of the organization in terms of what they want to do differently? Can we use the play of the game to open people's minds, to get them actively involved, to get them to help create a set of considered alternatives that the business could choose to do differently that would make an impact on the people in the room. Now, my ideal situation is to play the game at the senior level, maybe with 30 people or so. So you got a really good critical mass, and then debrief the game around those desired future outcomes for the business, and then discuss the critical need for active ownership involvement and get the senior leaders to help deliver the game. Get them to build the sweat equity in learning how to co-facilitate the game. And then with that active involvement, it totally changes the reactions they have to the ideas for improvement. It's hard to do. Usually these things go bottoms up and eventually the middle level managers get involved. But if we can start at the top, I mean, my preferred way to do a big game like 600 people is to take the top 20 senior managers, play the game, debrief the game, do the train the trainer, and then have me facilitate the game with all their people. So they're not sitting at a desk somewhere, not in a room. They're off their seat, on their feet, working to try to change the organizational culture. It's a powerful visual, much less all the side benefits you get from active engagement.
Yeah, I mean, backed up by it, as Jim's typed in, is yeah, without senior buy-in, you do need that. I'm just conscious of how hard. Well, I'm conscious of. Let me finish the saying the thought in my head out to the rest of you so you can hear it as well. I'm conscious of how difficult that is, and I don't want that to stop these things happening. But maybe it has to happen for that to work. And Elise, to grab your question, how do you bring new facilitators, James, into the world? Get talking to them, and ex get them co-running things. I mean, that's how I've learnt about this under Jim Warman. That's how I've done this. That's how I've got more experienced at this. Is that and I mean, then there might be some without revealing commercial things, there might be some courses available at some point, but really it is as per role-playing game DMs and GMs, it's learn through experience and especially run smaller things with lower stakes first or find people to learn under. But that's, as you all listen to me think out loud, that's a really good question. I ought to give you a better answer than that in a written form for the forum, at least, if not blog and LinkedIn and so on. Yeah, sorry, I'm going to finish my answer with that's a really good question. I will think about it more.
All right, awesome. And I saw Jim's answer too. I think it looks like there's some interest and some enthusiasm to get playing.
Oh yeah,
So
but I'm
you've
do
lit us, you've lit a fire for us.
sort of do bear in mind how many of the audience I know and how many have come from a games background, which is I don't know, well, oh, looking at the time, yes, it's very frustrating because everybody should see the benefit of this. It's and part of doing this is a lot of people who understand the benefit of games, and especially not like myself that much, is a part of the presentation that was skipped by me, I should stress. Rather, well, no, by your choices actually. Is I'm not that into recreational games. They just don't interest me. It's professional games based on very real situations that help people make decisions is what I'm interested in. I discovered them by accident 20 to 25 years ago. I think they're amazingly educational and informative, and I'm astounded business professionals aren't playing them monthly, if not weekly, to understand their business situation more. So I hope people like that, rather than a lot of games professionals we've got here, appreciate that and start doing something, because I think it gives you massive competitive advantages. Your company can move so much faster and make so much better decisions than keep having meetings and just kind of arguing and shouting at each other.
Ha 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 ha!